2,000 years ago, 13 people sat down to eat what would become the most famous meal in history. On the table was a dish of bread and a goblet of wine. Before they started eating, one of their number announced that that very evening he would be betrayed by one of his friends, and that that betrayal would lead to his death. Then he passed the bread to his shocked companions, and they each took a piece. He offered them the goblet, and they had a sip of wine. "Do this," he said, "in remembrance of me." The speaker was, of course, Jesus Christ, the occasion, the Last Supper, the event on which the Christian communion is based. It's also the event at the heart of any quest for the Holy Grail, because the Grail is the chalice from which the disciples sip that night. Or is it?
Could it instead be something much more mysterious? Is the true nature of the Grail encoded in this picture of the Last Supper? Is this disciple a woman?
Is Leonardo da Vinci trying to reveal an important secret that history has forgotten or even suppressed? The answer to all these questions is yes, according to this book, which has taken the world by storm. It's a thriller called The Da Vinci Code, and it's a modern-day quest for the Holy Grail. Its author, Dan Brown, is in no doubt at all that the Grail exists. But for him, it's not a cup, it's a secret. A 2,000-year-old secret. In fact, the most important secret in the history of the Western world. It goes like this. Jesus was married, yes, you heard me right, actually married to Mary Magdalene, who was thought of as holy and was worshipped like him by the early church. But that's not all. She and Jesus had a baby, so there's a holy bloodline. But the Catholic Church suppressed the truth. In a massive fit of institutionalized sexism, it airbrushed the marriage and the baby out of history and turned Mary Magdalene into a prostitute.
If the Da Vinci Code's right, the repercussions are huge. It means the Christian church is founded on a lie, and it means the descendants of Christ are walking the earth today. But is it right? It's very hard to tell, because while the Da Vinci Code's clearly a novel, a work of fiction, this is what its author says about it.
All of the art, architecture, secret rituals, secret societies, all of that is historical fact.
Let's just hear that again.
All of the art, architecture, secret rituals, secret societies, all of that is historical fact.
I'm going on a Grail quest of my own to untangle the confusion and answer some of the key questions in the book. Was Mary Magdalene the wife of Christ and mother of his child? Was this secret discovered by a band of warrior monks and protected by a secret society headed by Leonardo da Vinci? Or is the Holy Grail a cup? It's going to be one hell of a journey. I'm a complete beginner at this grail hunting business, so I'm going to start by following in the footsteps of Dan Brown's hero.
That's King's College London, but I'm looking for a particular department, which is this one, the Research Institute in Systematic Theology. Hiya. Can you tell me what the Research Institute of Systematic Theology is?
Go to the end of the corridor and turn left.
Cheers.
In the novel, the Institute possesses one of the biggest electronic research databases in the world, and the hero uses it to help him track down the Grail. which sounds very useful.
Hi, is this the Research Institute of Systematic Theology?
No, it's not.
Can you tell me where it is?
I can't really. It's not a building. It's just a group of people who we meet once a week to discuss, issues in systematic theology, and we hold conferences. So it's a kind of think tank.
It's just a bunch of academics talking.
Yes, that's right.
But you do have, don't you, the most sophisticated database on the Holy Grail of any institution in the world?
Well, we don't, as a matter of fact. We have our own personal computers and university computers, but we don't have a database of any kind whatsoever.
Not a very encouraging start. All the Institute of Systematic Theology have is a reading list, so I guess I'll have to do my own legwork.
And here it all is. Well, not quite all. This is just a spit in the ocean compared with all the books that have been written over the years about the Holy Grail. Nevertheless, this is quite a daunting prospect, and I have to be honest with you, I'm not going to be able to get through all these. Although I will give it a good go, but I'm not going to start there. Nor am I going to start with that one. Although the Da Vinci Code will get a look in later on. No, I'm going to start with that.
For nearly 1,000 years before the Da Vinci Code, most people thought the Holy Grail, if it existed at all, was a cup. And if I'm going to stand a chance of getting to grips with Dan Brown's extraordinary secret grail, I need first to investigate the enduring and deep-rooted tradition he's rejected. And so to my first quest. Is the Holy Grail a cup?
I've always thought of the Holy Grail as a cup out of the Jesus story, probably a large goblet like one of those things that you have in Holy Communion, maybe made of gold and studded with jewels and possibly some light emanating from it. But am I right? Is it a cup? Is it that kind of size? Does it exist at all? Is it studded with jewels? Well, I'm about to find out because I'm going to meet someone who believes he has the Holy Grail in his possession.
This is Hawkstone Manor in Shropshire, and I've come here to meet a man who not only believes the Holy Grail is a cup, he says it's actually in his possession.
The fact that this may be the cup that did have something to do with Jesus' time and that may have being the inspiration for the Grail legends that we now know. That, to me, is awe-inspiring.
The story begins in the 18th century, when the manor's owner built a kind of historical theme park in the gardens. He built castles, follies, and even carved strange grottos into the hillside. Then a neighbour, an antiquarian called Thomas Wright, filled the place with symbols and statues from the past. It was very popular, but no one thought for a minute it was the resting place of the Holy Grail.
Then, in 1920, something very strange happened. Workmen had been instructed to shift four statues which were in a grotto in this cave, and they were very cumbersome and heavy, and one of them got dropped, and it shattered, revealing a small stone cup which had apparently been hidden inside it. But it was a pretty ordinary-looking thing, and no-one thought much about it, and it just disappeared into the house along with a load of other bric-a-brac. Until 10 years ago, a researcher came across it and identified it as the Holy Grail.
That researcher was Graham Phillips. He was working on a book about King Arthur, and as he trawled through the archives, he found a document which suggested Wright had hidden the Holy Grail in the park. Phillips then decoded clues left by Wright, which led him to what he now calls the Hawkstone Grail.
And this is the Holy Grail?
Well, it looks like an egg cup or an old mustard pot, but when it was taken to the British Museum, they immediately identified it as a first century Roman scent jar.
It's a bit small, isn't it?
The cup would probably have been used either for containing spices, scent, or ointments, which again fits in with what the Bible says about Mary Magdalene going to the tomb of Jesus To anoint his body with spices.
Oh, so you don't think this was the cup that the communion was drunk out of?
No, this is a completely separate Grail legend, which is to do with the fact that Mary Magdalene collected a few drops of Jesus' blood where she saw him in the garden around the Holy Sepulchre. And that story became a Grail legend at the same time as the story of the cup of the Last Supper. This may be the one that Mary Magdalene used.
Some sceptical academics say that you're making this up, don't they?
I'm not making it up. Thomas Wright might be making it up. He might be making up that this chalice had been in his family's possession for many years. But again, if he was a hoaxer and somebody who wanted to claim that he had the real Holy Grail, which is what he claimed he had, then he would have presumably have had something far more elaborate, not just a simple cup. And it also one that he happens to have come from the right place and time.
This is a folly, though, isn't it? Isn't this exactly the kind of place where you'd expect some kind of elaborate hoax to take place?
It is, but the interesting thing about this place being a folly is that nobody actually knows quite why it was built, and it does seem to have been an awful lot of trouble that somebody's gone to excavate half a mountain away, which is really what they've done, just for a joke.
It's time to phone a friend or two. I couldn't go on a quest for the Holy Grail without a bit of expert backup, could I?
Hoxton Manor was built in the 18th century, and it's full of follies and ruins and hermitages. It represents this very playful attitude to architecture and nature. But it's always a problem to take these things too literally and too seriously. And a lot of Grail theories, unfortunately, get off the ground because somebody sees something which was either a joke or a bit of playful medieval symbolism and takes it very, very seriously.
Wright never meant it to be the Grail. It was just a sort of decoration, as far as I can tell, which he had added. He never writes about it. He never says anything about it. And there is no documentation as to what he was thinking about when he put it there.
Graham's clearly convinced that this is a Grail, the inspiration behind the Holy Grail legends, but I don't think so. For a start, I don't feel anything from it. No tingle, nothing. Apart from that, maybe I'm just not worthy of the Grail. Although, looking at it, I think, quite frankly, it's the other way round. I mean, is this the cup that launched 1,000 quests? I don't think so. No, we can do better than this, can't we? This is altogether more promising. Valencia in southern Spain. A church. No, a cathedral. And inside it, a relic called the Santa Caliz, the Holy Goblet. The church take it very seriously. It's even been venerated by the Pope as an important holy relic. But is it the Holy Grail? It certainly looks the part, although sadly the supposed Grail is actually this boring brown bit on the top.
Science tells us that it is from the time of Jesus Christ and of the land of Jesus Christ. So we can combine the archaeological proof with the historical proof and that of tradition. All this leads us to think that the Holy Grail, the object of so many searches, so many stories, is the one in Valencia.
But there's a problem. Science can't date the bowl, it's stone, and most experts say its design is 3rd century, 200 years after Christ. It's really the mount that makes it look special, and that's probably what led to it being adopted as a Christian relic. Unfortunately, the mount is an 11th century Arabian creation.
The first time the Valencia Grail appears as the cup of the Last Supper is really post-medieval. There are links with the Grail in the medieval period because the kings of Aragon who presented it to Valencia were undoubtedly interested in the Grail, and they may have said it was, but the church didn't.
So is it the Grail?
No.
Naught out of two. There's a pattern emerging. In fact, among all the legends in which the Holy Grail appears as a cup, there's not a single one that Grail experts accept as being historically credible. and the reason for that is not that no one's managed to find it yet, it's that the Grail never existed in the first place. Someone invented it 1,000 years after the Last Supper. But who, and why do so many people believe it's true? The answer lies here in France.
This is the forest of Broceliande in Brittany, and in the late 11th century, the French writer Chrétien de Troyes used this amazing scenery as the backdrop to one of the first novels ever written. It was called The Conte du Graal, The Story of the Grail, and in it, some characters who are very familiar to us today make their very first appearance.
Hello! Who is it?
It is King Arthur, and these are my knights of the Round Table. Go and tell your master that we have been charged by God with a sacred quest. If he will give us food and shelter for the night, he can join us in our quest for the Holy Grail.
Well, I'll ask him, but I don't think he'll be very keen. He's already got one, you see?
In Chrétien's original story, the characters are just as colourful as the Python knights, and they too are hunting for the Holy Grail. And this is what happens. Percival, one of the knights of the Round Table, finds himself in a mysterious castle where he witnesses an extraordinary procession. A man carries a lance dripping with blood, and a beautiful maiden carries a golden platter encrusted with jewels, the Holy Grail. This is its first appearance in any form of writing anywhere in the world.
There is no reference to the Grail before Chrétien de Troyes.
When Percival wakes up the next morning, every trace of the procession has gone. So he sets off on a quest with King Arthur to discover the secrets of the Holy Grail.
And then... that's where the story ends, because Chrétien died before he could reveal what happened next.
And so began a fascination with the Grail that was to last for centuries, because Chrétien's death had robbed not just his knights, but his readers too, of an explanation of his mysterious Grail.
And so a question mark is left in the mind of the audience in the 12th century. What was this thing? What was this item? Later writers in the next 50 years become fascinated by this question, and this so-called Grail becomes one of the key central features of romance stories, romance histories, in the late 12th and early 13th century.
There was an enormous string of continuations of the original romance. Other people picked it up and said, this is a good idea, I want to write my own version of it. And within 30 or 40 years, there was something like 5 major versions of the Grail story, an extraordinary explosion given this pace of sort of medieval life and the development of literature.
The romances were extraordinarily popular. I mean, they were really at the cutting edge of popular literature for the aristocratic class of the time.
In some ways, the Arthurian Grail romances are pretty similar to the Da Vinci Code. They're both popular, successful novels. They're both about the quest for the Holy Grail. And most significantly, from our point of view, they both try to convince the reader that what's inside their covers could actually be true.
For a start, the Grail itself appears to be a real object.
If you read the first romance about the Grail very carefully, Chrétien is clearly thinking of the cup of the Last Supper and the dish of the Last Supper in the references to the Grail. He's trying to present this as a possible relic of the Last Supper.
The later versions of the Grail stories also feature real historical characters, like Longinus, the Roman soldier who pierced Christ's side with a spear, and Joseph of Arimathea, the man who actually buried Christ's body. And many of the authors claim the stories have been handed down from original sources. So, no surprise, people began to believe that the Holy Grail that King Arthur and his knights had pursued through the pages of Chrétien's novel might actually exist. But, of course, it doesn't. The romances are fiction.
For us, a writer is a good writer if he's original. For a medieval writer, the idea was not to be original, but the idea was to be traditional. The idea was that you took a body of stories which existed beforehand and you treated them in an unusual and clever way. And that was their aesthetic. As a result of which, many of the medieval writers claim that, oh, I didn't write this story, I got it from someone else. But of course, this is a game that the medieval writers are playing. This is part of the conceit of their writing. They knew that their audience knew that they were the authors of this story.
The important thing about the Grail in Chrétien is that he creates it. He doesn't get the idea from anywhere. It is something that comes out of his imagination.
I think one of the problems we have is that people who are fascinated by the Holy Grail in the modern world, people who like to develop conspiracy theories around it or suggest that it is imminently going to be discovered, are misinterpreting history. They're looking to the past and they're looking actually to what is fictional writing, and they're assuming it's historical. And it's the equivalent of people in the future, 1,000 years from now, people looking back to our literature and suggesting that it's real, that you could look back to the 20th and 21st century and suggest that everyone believed in Lord of the Rings and that really there was this Middle Earth. That's the equivalent for looking back to the Middle Ages, the 12th and 13th century, and suggesting that there truly was a round table at the Knights of King Arthur and this fascination in a physical Holy Grail.
So the Grail is a cup after all. Unfortunately, only in a medieval novel. It's not real. At least, that's what everybody thought until the mid-1980s. And then, something rather extraordinary happened.
In 1982, a very unusual book called The Holy Blood and the Holy Grail was published. It was marketed as history, but was written like a thriller and sold like a thriller. And it changed everything.
Why? Because it overturned the 800-year-old theory that the Grail was a cup containing the blood of Jesus Christ, and instead came up with something much more radical, that the Grail was the secret bloodline of Jesus Christ, that he'd married Mary Magdalene, they'd had a child, and the church had kept the truth suppressed for 2,000 years. And if that sounds familiar, well, it should, because it's the theory that underpins the Da Vinci Code.
Not surprisingly, the new theory introduced a raft of new characters. Mary Magdalene, an order of Christian soldiers called the Knights Templar, a mysterious organization called the Priory of Sion, and the next stop on my quest, a bunch of French heretics called the Cathars. Were they the guardians of the Holy Grail? They were, according to the new theory, which claims they hid it in this fortress. My quest for the Holy Grail is taking me to the heart of a book called The Holy Blood and the Holy Grail, and to the heart of Grail Country. Here, in an area between the Spanish border and Marseille, the book's authors discovered a remarkable series of historical coincidences which appeared to lead them to the Grail.
There seemed to be something going on. There was a lot of smoke. I wanted to find out whether there was any fire behind that smoke.
A lot of the smoke appeared to surround a real heretical sect called the Cathars, who were active in southern France in the early Middle Ages, and who, according to local tradition, had hidden the Holy Grail in the mountains of Languedoc.
Well, this looks like it, isn't it? I'm told that through here, there's actually some cave paintings on the wall of the cave. Oh, this looks like something, doesn't it? There's clearly a sword there. You can see that very clearly, can't you? And a cross there. And there's more crosses on the other side going down here. Up here, there seems to be, I'm not sure if you can see that, but sort of lance. And there's this big square thing here, like a casket or a book. Can you see this round thing here with bits sticking out like an old-fashioned naval mine or a conker or something? They reckon that could be a chalice. These are obviously images from the 12th and 13th century romances, the fictional grail of King Arthur. But a lot of people believe that these are clues left behind by the Cathars, a kind of code to show that the real grail, whatever it was safely in their possession.
The grail in Holy Blood, Holy Grail is no cup. Its authors call it the line of David, the secret bloodline of Jesus and Mary Magdalene. And the book suggests not only that the Cathars were in on the secret, it was the very basis of their heresy.
It seems as though they knew the truth, or some of the truth, about Jesus as a man. Some of them had legends of a relationship with Magdalene, or perhaps secrets about the line of Jesus running through the south of France.
The event at the heart of this and many other theories linking the Cathars to the Holy Grail occurred in 1244. It happened at the end of a six-month siege here at Montségur in the Pyrenees. The Cathars were making their final stand against the church-backed crusade that had all but destroyed them.
By March 1244, both sides knew that the game was up. The attackers gave the defenders a final ultimatum. Either surrender the castle and recant your heresy, in which case you'll get away with a light penance, or if you don't, we'll storm the castle and kill you. The Cathars stayed put for 14 days. They celebrated Easter, and then they simply swung open the castle doors and walked out.
Soldiers and sympathisers were released with a penance, and all the Cathar priests, or perfects, were burned at the stake. Well, perhaps not quite all.
The historical records tell us that the night before the ultimatum expired, four perfecti sneaked out of the castle, down the hill, through the enemy lines, and got away to safety. And they were carrying something. And it's that mysterious cargo that's attracted the Grail hunters.
Now, this can't have been any kind of treasure to do with gold and jewels, because we know that the physical treasure, the gold and jewels, was taken out several months earlier. So we have to ask the question, what could four people carry down ropes with this descent down cliffs? And we suggest in our book that they're carrying documents.
According to the Holy Blood and the Holy Grail, the documents apparently contained important secrets the Cathars wanted to keep from the church, including perhaps the secret of the Holy Bloodline. But historians are unimpressed by this intriguing hypothesis.
There is some evidence which comes mainly from two of the records of interrogations by the Inquisition, that something was removed from Montségur on the night before the castle formally surrendered. We have absolutely no idea what it was, and it's obvious that the two people whose interrogations this come from did not themselves know what it was. That is the sum total of our knowledge. We have absolutely no idea.
So who were the mysterious Cathars really? And is there anything in their heresy that suggests knowledge of the secret bloodline?
The Cathars were a heresy which flourished in parts of Europe, and particularly southwest France, in the 12th and 13th centuries. They denied that God was all-powerful. They denied that he had created everything. They believed that Satan had created the material world, and that was the explanation of evil. They certainly would not have thought well of the notion that Jesus Christ married Mary Magdalene and had children. They believed that marriage and procreation were evils, and even if they might occasionally be unavoidable evils, it was the duty of the perfects to avoid them. There is no evidence that the Cathars were the guardian of any secret. They were not particularly secretive about their own beliefs. There is no reason to suppose that they had some secret in their control about Christianity generally. There is no reason to suppose that they were the custodians of any physical object, whether the Grail or something different.
There isn't any evidence, is there, that the Cathars were in possession of any kind of secret?
What sort of secrets would you have in mind? The Inquisition went to enormous effort to wipe them out. That in itself means they must have been in possession of something that the Inquisition didn't want, either secrets of how to contact divinity directly, or secrets about Jesus, or perhaps secrets about the line of David running through the south of France. Remember, this was in the same area that the Cathars were at their strongest.
I'm with the historians on this one. I don't believe for a minute the Cathars had anything to do with the Holy Grail. But it seems the bloodline theory can survive their loss, because according to Holy Blood, Holy Grail, there's another unusual medieval organization with its roots in Grail country. Like the Cathars, the Knights Templar were associated with the possession of treasure. They were accused of heresy and destroyed by the church. But did they also discover and protect the Holy Grail? They did in the Da Vinci Code, and in a myriad of other theories.
I've just typed the words Knights Templar and Grail into an internet search engine, and there are 44,300 entries, including some really very interesting ones like Knights Templar and the Grail in Nova Scotia, and this one, the Knights Templar and the Holy Grail and cannabis. Good Lord. Well, it is the internet after all, but what it does seem to show is that the Knights Templar have become inextricably linked with the Grail.
The first thing to say about the Knights Templar is that they did actually exist. They were a monastic order founded shortly after the First Crusade to protect pilgrims travelling to the Holy Land. They were based in Jerusalem. That much of their story, at least, is fact.
This area over here is the Temple Mount, or the Haram al-Sharif, depending on who you ask. And that golden-domed building is a mosque, which sits on the site of the Temple of Herod, which was built about 40 or so years before Jesus was born. And according to Dan Brown and the writers of Holy Blood, Holy Grail, it was right here, underneath its ruins, that the Knights Templar discovered the secret of the Holy Grail.
According to both Holy Blood, Holy Grail and the Da Vinci Code, one of their tasks in Jerusalem was to recover the secrets of the Grail, a stash of documents buried shortly after the crucifixion, proving that Jesus and Mary Magdalene had had a child. And both books tell us that for 9 years, the knights dug covertly into the rock here under the temple.
What do you think the Templars found in Jerusalem?
I have no idea what they found, but there was plenty of things they could have found. The Copper Scroll, for example, which was one of the Dead Sea Scrolls, gave a list of various repositories around the temple and around the countryside of documents, of jewels, of gold, of temple dishes. They could have found any of those things. They could have found documents.
Whatever it was something pretty special, because its discovery, the books say, made the Templars fantastically wealthy and powerful. They accumulated vast estates across Europe and enjoyed patronage at the courts of kings. And that's not all.
I am convinced there was heresy within the Templar order. There's too much sloshing around the Inquisition reports to deny it. And a pattern emerges of quite a different approach to Christianity.
For nearly 200 years, so the theory goes, the heretical Templars managed to keep themselves and their secrets safe. And then, in 1307, in a bid to get hold of the secret for himself, Philip IV of France attacked them.
It was a perfectly executed coup. Philip gave secret orders to his officials throughout France, and on the 13th of October 1307, they pounced. Every Templar in the whole of France was arrested and interrogated. Many were tortured. In 1311, the Pope dissolved the order, and one of the most powerful organizations in the whole of medieval Europe simply ceased to exist.
It's an attractive theory which clearly appeals to a lot of people. And it's got one thing right. The order was accused of heresy and destroyed. But the rest of it, according to historians, is rubbish. For a start, the Templars didn't find anything under the temple.
We do not have any evidence for any excavations carried out by the knights in Solomon's stables. That level is approximately 47 meters above the surface, the original surface of the Herodian dynasty. Just imagine, 50 meters to dig down. I don't think they did it.
So if I'd been a Knight Templar and I wanted to dig down for the Holy Grail, I would have had to have dug down further than the depth of that wall.
Much deeper, just 2.5 times the height of this wall. It's unbelievable.
And in thousands of contemporary documents, there's not a shred of evidence to connect them to the Grail, or indeed secrets of any kind. So step forward, the real Knights Templar.
The Templars, the Knights of Christ in the Temple of Solomon in Jerusalem, to give them their full title, were a group of warriors who founded a military religious institution in Jerusalem in about 1120. They are fighting men in chainmail. They came out to Jerusalem on pilgrimage and they wanted to do something practical for God. And as far as they were concerned, the most practical thing they could do was to use their swords fighting to defend other Christians.
There's no mystery about the money either.
They get donations from pilgrims who come out to the East. Clearly, people who were very wealthy could give them great donations, and they're given vast sums of thousands of pounds by rich people that came out on crusade and whom the Templars had helped. Much better than just giving money to your local monastery. The monastery would pray for you. The Templars would pray for you too, but they would also do something useful.
In fact, their wealth and their geographical spread enabled them to set up a really handy service for travelling nobles. A noble would deposit money with his local Templars, and in return, he'd get a promissory note. And when he got to the place he was going to, he'd present the note to the local Templars there and withdraw the cash. The Knights Templar invented international banking.
Unusual may be, but not sinister. And certainly not heretical.
The Templar heresies, so-called, were not inspired by their knowledge of the bloodline of Christ, because only the Templars that were tortured confessed to denying Christ. And then as soon as they stopped being tortured, many of them went back on their confessions and said, I only confessed to that because I was tortured. Apart from those that confessed under torture, none of the Templars admitted to denying Christ, and they hotly denied that they would ever do any such thing.
In fact, the Pope himself found no credible evidence of Templar heresy, and in 1314 he dropped the charges. He directed his anger instead on his own inquisitors for embellishing the testimony. But by then, of course, it was too late, and the seeds of 1,000 quests had been sown.
The Templars, I think, come into Grail lore because their end in the Middle Ages has always been something of a mystery. Here was an immensely powerful order destroyed overnight, and it's when something cataclysmic happens that people look for explanations.
But you don't have to dig under a temple to find one.
King Philip IV of France wanted their money because they had vast tracts of land, and land meant money.
My view is that the Templars came down because they were too wealthy and they had no longer got an obvious purpose in life, and there was somebody who had a better use for their money.
That sounds pretty convincing to me, but conspiracy theories are harder to destroy than a mere band of warrior monks, so in spite of the evidence against it, the tradition of the Templar Grail lives on. not least in the Da Vinci Code, which claims the Templars actually hid the Grail in this splendid Gothic church in Scotland. And some people believe it's still there. I'm halfway through my quest for the Holy Grail, and so far, I've not had much luck. My hunt for a real cup ended in the pages of a medieval French novel. And neither the Cathars nor the Templars seem likely guardians of the secret Da Vinci Code Grail. So where now? Well, no Grail quest could miss a visit to Roslyn Chapel. According to the book and myriad other Grail theories, something to do with the secret Grail, perhaps even the Grail itself, was hidden somewhere in this splendid Scottish church.
If they're right, then I'm just about as close to the Holy Grail as I'm ever going to get, maybe as little as 10 or 15 feet away, because they say that it's buried down there somewhere. Feels like it could be.
Grail hunters have been attracted to Roslyn Chapel like moths to a flame. And it's mainly down to these extraordinary symbols, which many claim are a secret code encapsulating information about the Holy Grail.
The basis of the theory is this. The agents of the Roslyn Grail, well, guess who? The Knights Templar. Some of them escaped Philip IV's coup and brought the Grail to Scotland. When they got here, they became involved with the Scottish Freemasons. In fact, they may even have founded them, and they gave them the Grail for safekeeping. The Masons built this chapel to hide it in, and they encoded its secrets into the architecture. Who built this place?
William Sinclair built it. Built it in 1440, it was started, 1440 AD. It probably took about 50 years to build.
So why is it that this place is so popular with Grail hunters?
Well, mainly because of the fact that the place connects strongly with, of course, the word Grail. These big engrailed crosses up here.
What crosses?
They're called engrailed crosses. They have like little cups all the way up, if you follow meaning, or spikes, whichever you like to look at it.
So in that case, there's probably about 4,000 little grails carved.
Yes, but that is the coat of arms of the Sinclair family. So William Sinclair has his coat of arms, his engrailed cross, all over the place.
Roslyn has found itself the focus of a variety of different grail theories. Some have claimed that Grail secrets lie underneath this pillar, the Prentice Pillar, encased in a lead casket. Others are convinced that the Grail was actually Christ's head that the Templars buried here. And in the Da Vinci Code, the Grail was temporarily hidden at Roslyn after the Templars were disbanded. But some people, including a relative of the church's founder, believe it's still here.
My name is Sinclair. It's a family place, which has become probably the most mysterious chapel in the whole of Northern Europe.
Sinclair was convinced that his ancestor, the Earl of Sinclair, was in on the Grail secret, and he'd hidden the Grail in the chapel, which he designed to echo the floor plan of the temple where the Templars had supposedly found it.
Without doubt, Roslyn Chapel was built as a chapel of the Grail.
But at this point, Sinclair had no proof. Then, in the late 1990s, in a Masonic lodge in the Orkneys, he made an astonishing discovery. The Kirkwall Scroll.
It is quite extraordinary It is 18 foot long, 6 foot wide, and the biggest medieval scroll, I think, in Europe. In the middle of the Kirkpall scroll, you have the ground plan of the Temple of Solomon, which contains in two vaults the Holy of Holies and the Ark of the Covenant. It is exactly the ground plan of Roslin Chapel. And if you superimpose one on the other, you will find that they exactly coincide, where we know there are these vaults under Roslin Chapel.
This was incredible. Sinclair had the scroll carbon dated. It was 15th century, precisely when Roslin was built. The Grail was almost in his grasp.
I managed to get crews in to dig down to the vaults. But I never reached them, because in the end, even when we got an endoscope down to look for this vault, where indeed might be the Grails, as we pushed down the endoscope, all that happened was rubble filled in the vault.
Still filled.
And I thought in the end, perhaps these secrets and these grails should always be hidden.
Well, maybe he couldn't find it, but I might have a go.
I know a bunch of really highly qualified archaeologists who'd love to do some work here. Can we dig?
No. That's the short answer. Permission would be required by a number of people, including the Trust. And all known and unknown grave sites are also protected in Scotland by something called Right of Sepulchre. And so as such, you just can't welly in here with loads of shovels and a JCB, I'm afraid.
We never use a JCB, you know that.
Yes, you do. You scrape the top off. I've seen you do it.
So it looks like I'm not going to find it either. But even if I could get permission to dig, what's the likelihood of there being anything there to find? One man who should be able to tell me is Robert Cooper, a historian who's made a special study of the Roslin Grail.
What's the link between the Knights Templar and Roslin?
As far as I am aware, there is none. They came here, as some authors claim, in 1307, just prior to their mass arrest in France. There is a period of almost 140 years before Roslin Chapel is built. Now, even these very mystical Knights Templar, I don't think, can live for that long.
I'm not sure we can dismiss Roslin out of hand, given the evidence of the Kirkwall scroll. Here we've got a medieval document, properly dated. We've got this kind of map of the Crusaders around the outside. And in the middle, we've got this plan of the temple looking suspiciously like the ground plan of Roslin. Fairly compelling.
Well, the thought that this is a medieval artifact comes from the fact that someone had threads radiocarbon dated. But as you know, that can be very inaccurate, up to an error margin of 700 years either way.
Oh, people always say that when they want to challenge dates.
Well, yes, indeed. There are other clues, if you like, within the artifact itself that show us that it comes from a much later period.
Like what?
Well, this shows the armorial bearings of the Grand Lodge of England, which tells us...
What does that mean, armorial bearings?
It's the coat of arms.
Yeah.
And we know that this was drawn in 1751, no earlier than that. So the actual artifact could not have been made until after this had been devised. So it's from the middle of the 18th century at the very earliest. We are told, for instance, that this is a plan of King Solomon's temple. Mm. In fact, this is the tabernacle in the desert, and you can see the tents of the 12 tribes of Israel around it.
So you don't think that the Holy Grail is buried at Roslin?
No, and I think we can say that with a great degree of certainty, because it's been an extremely busy place. Very shortly after the chapel was begun, people were arranging to be buried in the chapel itself. And we know that 9 generations of the St. Clair family, some of their wives and probably some of the children, were all buried there as well. So, frankly, I can't believe that all these hundreds of people over the years trotting in and out of the family burial vault never noticed anything worth putting in their pocket, shall we say.
So, no Templar connection, no coded symbols, and no Grail. Which pretty much rules Roslyn Chapel out of my inquiries. But what happens if the Templars gave the Grail to someone else? To a secret society headed by Leonardo da Vinci? That's the suggestion in the best-selling novel The Da Vinci Code, and lots of readers seem to think it could be true. In The Da Vinci Code, Dan Brown tells the story of a modern-day quest for the Holy Grail. The Grail itself is the secret bloodline of Jesus Christ, who married Mary Magdalene and fathered her child. It's a secret the Church has been suppressing for 2,000 years and is still trying to actively destroy. Indeed, it would have done if it hadn't been for a remarkable organisation called the Priory of Sion. It's a secret society that was founded by descendants of Jesus. They're dedicated to preserving the Grail, which they possess to this very day. A fascinating theme for a work of fiction. Well, that's what I thought, until I came to a page at the beginning where Dan Brown makes a surprising claim. The Priory of Sion, a European secret society founded in 1099, is a real organization.
All of the art, architecture, secret rituals, secret societies, all of that is historical fact.
It's an extraordinary thing to say, isn't it? That there's a secret society that no one's ever heard of, that's had the Grail in its possession for over 1,000 years and does so to this very day. It's incredible. Well, yeah, it is actually. It's a con. And it's a con that's fooled a whole generation of Grail hunters.
The origins of this con stretch back to 1890, to a priest in a remote French village who became mysteriously wealthy. The local legend was that he'd found treasure. The village was Rennes-le-Château in southwest France. Yep, you guessed it, right in the heart of Grail country. Fast forward to 1967. The little local mystery gets the first of 2 major embellishments. This time, the author is French journalist Gérard de Sède. He claimed the priest had found not treasure, but an extraordinary mystery. And this is the story de Sède told.
While the church was being renovated, the priest, Béranger Saunier, discovered in a broken pillar some ancient parchments, including these coded documents. What they meant was a complete mystery, but clearly it was a mystery of some importance.
Because, according to de Sède, Saunier's bishop sent him to Paris to show the documents to the church authorities. And when he came back, he appeared to have become suddenly wealthy. He built a lavish villa for himself, complete with expensive folly in the garden. Not only that, but he began frantically digging for something around the church.
The implication was very clear. He'd stumbled upon a secret that was so important that the church authorities were prepared to throw money at him to buy his silence. And presumably, there was more of that secret left to find.
Leonardo said had launched the hoax. Enter its first victim, writer and broadcaster Henry Lincoln, co-author of Holy Blood, Holy Grail. He'd read de Sed's book about the Wren mystery and was intrigued. Lincoln set about researching the story himself and was soon drawn into the mysterious world of the Priory of Sion. He contacted Gerard de Sed, and together they managed to decipher the two parchments. The first was cryptic. This treasure belongs to King Dagobert II and to Sion, and he is there dead. The second was pure gobbledygook. Shepherdess, no temptation. That Poussin Tenier holds the key. P 681. By the cross and this horse of God, I complete this daemon guardian at midday, blue apples. At the end of it was a signature, P.S.
What did it all mean? Deciphering the code was one thing, understanding it was another. Lincoln was at a loss until he came here, to the Bibliothèque Nationale in Paris.
But Lincoln didn't just turn up here on the off chance of finding something. According to co-researcher Michael Bagent, he'd been directed.
The first set of documents had been given to Henry, or made available to Henry, through a group called the Priory of Sion. And the Priory of Sion also tipped us off about other documents in the National Library of Paris, which we then went to see what they were.
And this is what he eventually found, the so-called dossier secret, the secret dossiers. Actually, these are just copies because we can't look at the originals because they're virtually falling to pieces, they've been handled so much, although that's only been in recent years. When Lincoln found them, they were in pretty good nick, and they were a most bizarre and extraordinary collection of papers. There's a whole host of genealogies to do with the Merovingian kings of France. And this fascinating thing, which is a list of the Grand Masters of the Priory of Sion. And you can see the Grand Masters include Leonardo da Vinci there, Robert Boyle, Isaac Newton, Victor Hugo, Debussy.
Why would this group give us documents? What did they want? We were suspicious because we assumed, and I think correctly, that they were trying to manipulate us. They were trying to lead us in a particular direction. So every document we got from this group, we had to check and test. And it took us years of checking and testing. But at the end of it all, everything we could check proved accurate.
Eventually, they pieced together a remarkable portrait of the mysterious Priory of Sion.
It was founded as a secret society in the year 1099. It acted on behalf of an ancient French royal dynasty called the Merovingians. It created the Knights Templar as its military arm, and it had influence on major events in Western history.
That's a pretty astonishing CV. And amazingly, Lincoln's contact inside the secret organization agreed to discuss it in a TV interview.
Pouvez-vous nous dire si le prieuré de Sion existe encore aujourd'hui?
À l'heure actuelle, Sion existe toujours.
Monsieur Plantard, y a-t-il toujours un secret à Rennes-le-Château?
Mais le secret n'est pas seulement à Rennes-le-Château. Il est aussi autour de Rennes-le-Château.
Le trésor de Rennes-le-Château sera-t-il trouvé un jour?
Ici, vous me parlez d'un trésor matériel. Ne parlons pas de trésor matériel. Disons simplement qu'il existe un secret à Rennes-le-Château.
If the treasure at Rennes wasn't material, what was it? By now, Lincoln had been joined by two co-authors, Michael Bagent and Richard Lee.
As you know, the mystery which triggered the discovery which we eventually made, mm-hmm. which triggered the whole course of research, was concerned with a small village in France where a priest had apparently found a treasure. We looked into the history of that area and the Grail kept surfacing. And the Grail in turn leads us into the bloodline.
The trio somehow managed to connect Rennes-le-Château, the Priory, and the Merovingian dynasty to the very birth of Christianity. And if Gerard de Sede's account of the mystery at Rennes had been extraordinary, then Lincoln and Co.'s was positively mind-blowing. And this is it.
What the priest had discovered here at this church at Rennes-le-Château was a clue to the nature and possible location of the Holy Grail. But this grail wasn't a cup, it was blood, holy blood. The holy bloodline of Jesus Christ and his wife Mary Magdalene, a secret that had been suppressed by the Catholic Church for 2,000 years. And who had left this clue? The Priory of Sion, a secret organisation founded in the year 1099 by a descendant of Jesus and Mary that had kept the grail safe for centuries and does so to this very day.
In 1982, Lincoln and his co-authors published these findings in the book Holy Blood, Holy Grail, and the Priory of Sion was introduced to a worldwide audience. The book sold millions and made overnight stars of its authors.
I think the first day something like 43,000 copies were sold. Really was a circus.
The book horrified the church and academia, who both claimed it was hokum, but ordinary readers lapped it up and belief in the holy bloodline took root. One of the converts was the future author of The Da Vinci Code.
The most important fact is that the Holy Grail is not what people think it is. That is part of the theme of the book. The Holy Grail is not a cup, it is something far more powerful.
But as we'll see, Brown himself was just another victim of the Priory hoax. My quest for the Holy Grail has led me to Paris on the trail of a fantastic hoax. I'm investigating the mysterious Priory of Sion, a shady organisation at the heart of the Da Vinci Code that has supposedly guarded the Grail for 1,000 years. Yeah, and I'm a Dutchman. Enter Jean-Luc Chaumet, a French journalist who was to reveal the truth behind the Priory of Sion. Chaumet began his investigations into the Priory at around the same time as Lincoln and Co. were researching their book, but he was coming up with a very different story. He found all the documents led back to the same three colourful characters. Gerard de Sede, who sparked it all off with his book about the mystery at Rennes, Philip de Chérissy, a bored marquis, and Pierre Plantard, the public face of the Priory of Sion.
On va dire que Plantard était un personnage.
Plantard was like a character from another era, an extraterrestrial with the eyes and smile of a weasel.
What was de Chérissy like?
Chérissy était un acteur très érudit.
De Chérissy was a very erudite, very intelligent actor. He was difficult to understand because he used to drink too much.
À boire un peu trop.
Like Lincoln, Bagent and Lee, Chaumet spent years researching the Priory of Sion. And the more he read, the more he became convinced it was all a hoax. The parchments in the pillar, the dossier secret, and even the priory itself.
Where are the parchments? There are no parchments. There was a legend of parchments that contained a code to the treasure of Rennes-le-Château. So they created some parchments. To authenticate, to prove the existence of the Priory of Sion, they had to refer to it in the parchments. That was the work of Philippe de Chérissy.
And he had proof. These are the original parchments, with one important addition, an admission that they're forgeries into Chérissy's handwriting.
But there are other documents, aren't there? There's the dossier secret.
The dossier secret were, if you like, created to verify the whole story. What a job. What a job.
The list of Grand Masters, the descriptions of the Priory of Sion, the genealogies, all faked. According to Shomei, this genealogy was actually copied from a magazine. Plantard had cheekily added his own name to the end of a lineage of French kings. But he's about as royal as you or me.
I have a 44-page document from Philippe de Cherizet, a confession explaining how the thing, the whole thing, was done.
Beaucoup d'affaires. Comment ça a été réalisé? Ça, c'est l'écriture de Plantard.
Shomei uncovered the real facts about the Priory of Sion. It did exist, but it was by no means an ancient organization. It was set up in 1956 by Plantard himself. It only ever had 4 or 5 members, and it was named after a mountain in Plantard's hometown. It was all a fantasy.
De Cherizet says it has the structure of a good hoax.
Why had they done it? A clue in Plantard's TV interview.
Nous? Qui est ce nous?
Nous, je parle de la lignée mérovingienne. Car notre lignée est issue de Dagobert II. Les Mérovingiens, ce sont eux qui ont fait la France. Sans eux, il n'y aurait pas de France.
The whole scheme had been designed to give credibility to Plantard's personal fantasy that he was a descendant of the Merovingian dynasty and the heir to the French throne. De Cherizet helped him because it was fun, and De Cède was a member of a surrealist group called Olupilu.
The Priory of Sion was a surrealist concept. It was a piece of theatre created and performed by Gérard De Cède, Plantard, and De Cherizet.
So you've got this extraordinary piece of theatre. They're all working together to create this imaginary history.
Oui, c'est ça.
And more of a joke than a con, until Holy Blood, Holy Grail was published, when the whole thing got out of hand. The book's logic implied that Plantard, as a Merovingian, wasn't just a king in waiting, but a descendant of Christ. He panicked and denounced it.
Mais tout de même, il faut avouer que il y a une partie de roman, particulièrement pour tout ce qui concerne ma lignée depuis Jésus. Car comment voulez-vous qu'on puisse prouver 400 ans, pendant 400 ans, une lignée depuis Jésus jusqu'au Mérovingien? Je ne suis jamais présenté comme un descendant de Jésus.
After that, Plantard and De Cherizet ran for cover. And Gérard De Cède wrote a second book exposing the hoax he'd helped to launch.
When your father died, did he believe that there was an organization called the Priory of Sion?
Oh, no. I mean, I think he has said several times that this organization was a figment of Plantard's imagination, basically. It is absolute piffle.
I always knew there was never going to be some clear-cut historical link between Jesus and the Holy Grail in the 21st century. There were bound to be twists and turns and dead ends. But it never crossed my mind that the whole notion of a secret grail would have been something constructed in my own lifetime. And not only that, but constructed by people who are inspired by a particular kind of French philosophy that I've always found really attractive. In other words, surrealism. But of course, surrealism isn't just Salvador Dali and René Magritte. It's The Goon Show and John Cleese and Terry Jones. So I've got it now. Think Priory of Sion, think Monty Python and the Holy Grail.
You seek the Holy Grail!
That is our quest. You know much that is hidden, though, Tim.
Quite.
Only one question remains about the Priory of Sion hoax, the one that kicked it all off in the first place. Where did Priest Saunier get his money? And the answer isn't buried deep in some archive. It's in Sonia's own journals on display in the museum at Rennes.
He got rich through selling religious favours to wealthy nobles, a kind of you-give-me-100 quid and I'll make sure God blesses you scam. And here is perfect proof from his accounts. Thousands of masses that he sold in a village of only a couple of hundred people. A scandal, certainly, but not really a very mysterious one.
Chaumet's expose emerged before Holy Blood, Holy Grail went to print. In fact, Chaumet claims he warned Lincoln and his friends the whole thing was a hoax over a year before they finished writing their book.
Chaumet says that he told the three of you very early on that the whole thing was a hoax. Is that right?
I don't recall it, but then Chaumet was never necessarily very close to the inner groups of the Priory.
So his idea that the documents are fakes and the dossiers are fakes, you wouldn't accept?
No.
But presumably you could engage a bit with some of his allegations, which were, for instance, that the whole Priory is a surrealist fantasy that was created by two or three people and you inadvertently seized on it.
He's wrong.
Why are you so sure that he's wrong?
Because I've seen the documents, I've researched them, I spent 6 years looking at material and I'm satisfied that the Priory existed.
You might have expected, given the weight of evidence against it, that no one else who's researched the Priory of Sion would share Bajant's view. I certainly haven't met a single journalist or academic who does, but then I haven't met Dan Brown.
All of the art, architecture, secret rituals, secret societies, all of that is historical facts.
It's been widely known for at least the last 10 years that both the Priory of Sion and this dossier secret are complete fabrications.
Just when everyone thought the Priory of Sion was dead, Dan Brown's Da Vinci Code has regurgitated the whole myth as fact. Travel agents are cashing in, offering Da Vinci Code tours round the book's landmarks in Paris. Problem is, some of the tourists can't tell fact from fiction. In the book, Saint-Sulpice is the site of a former pagan temple, the location for a vicious murder in the quest for the Grail.
One of the details that the albino Opus Dei gentleman murders this nun using a candlestick he takes on the altar. And they are indeed beautiful gilt bronze candlesticks on the altar, but they are so large and so heavy that it takes two men just to move one. So they are not very easy weapon. A few expect to find the blood from the murdered nun on the floor, but of course they don't find anything like that.
It's also here that people look for the broken flagstone under which the monk hopes to find clues to lead him to the Grail. The church is, as you'd expect, very helpful on the matter.
Contrary to fanciful allegations in a recent best-selling novel, this is not a vestige of a pagan temple. No such temple ever existed in this place. It was never called a rose line. Please also note that the letters P and S in the small round windows refer to Peter and Sulpice, the patron saints of the church, not an imaginary Priory of Sion.
A stone's throw away, the Louvre, the scene of another of the book's gruesome murders. And it too is very popular with the Da Vinci Code tourists.
Do you think that the book is true?
A lot of it's based in fact. A lot of the things they describe you can see in the paintings. You just have to decide if you're interpreting the same way he is or not.
It's the interpretation that's open.
Hugely open.
Yes, a lot of license there.
Yes, a lot of.
But would you say you're entirely skeptical about it?
No, entirely. It makes a lot of sense. I wouldn't believe it 100%, but you can understand how people could agree with it for sure.
How about the Priory of Sion? Do you think that exists?
Well, there's been many cults through time that have existed that believe certain things and hold certain beliefs, carry them on in secretive waves. Maybe there was such a thing.
So the Da Vinci Code continues to cast a spell that blurs the distinction between fact and fiction, a point I wanted to discuss with its author.
We asked Dan Brown to take part in this film, but his agent said he's refusing all interviews because he's busy researching his next book.
So where does all this leave my quest for Dan Brown's Holy Grail? Apparently in tatters. No Cathars, no Templars, no Rosalind, and now no Priory of Sion. But perhaps there's something in the secret itself. My final quest. Was Mary Magdalene the carrier of the holy bloodline? This is Milan. And this is the Santa Maria della Grazia Church. Painted on one of its walls is the picture that gave the Da Vinci Code its name. The book uses the picture as an illustration of its central theme, that Mary Magdalene was the chief disciple, that she was married to Christ and was bearer of his holy bloodline.
Okay, here's the evidence. This is Leonardo da Vinci's The Last Supper, based on the story as told in the Gospel of St. John. Jesus has just told the disciples that one of them's going to betray him, and they're all shocked and horrified, and now he's about to break bread with them for the very last time. But is everything as it seems? In the Da Vinci Code, the Grail historian Lee Teabing shows the painting to the Grail hunter Sophie Naveau as evidence that Jesus was once married to Mary. He says to her, "Look at all the people round the table. What do you see?" And she says, "I see 13 men." He says, No. Look again, and this time look in particular at the one in the place of honor to Jesus' right. And she says, "It's a woman."
Teabing then goes on to point out some curious features in the composition of the painting. Jesus and Mary are joined at the hip, but leaning away from each other, creating a V shape, the symbol for chalice, grail, and female womb. That V is, in turn, part of an obvious letter M for Magdalene on matrimonio. So did Leonardo da Vinci encode the secret of the Grail in his painting? Is he trying to tell us that this is Mary Magdalene and she was married to Jesus?
Charles, when I first heard this allegation that St. John is actually a woman, I thought, oh yeah, that's one of those things that a few dotty people say, and when I see the painting, I'll see that it isn't really true. But it isn't until you get here that you see the profound difference between that figure and all the others. And this wasn't just me, our whole crew felt this. Steve, our sound man, the first time he saw it, he said, "This is a painting about her, not Jesus." And our director was saying, "It almost looks as though it was painted by a different person." I mean, it's quite extraordinary, isn't it?
Well, it's a very extraordinary face, and a very beautiful face, but it's not a woman, as far as I would interpret it. There's a scriptural narrative being presented here. The figure is that of Saint John, who was the disciple whom Jesus loved, as it says in the Bible, and in some skeptical and scurrilous circles, this was interpreted as a homosexual relationship. So there is a kind of tradition that shows John as an effeminate young man, a beautiful young man, and this is a type, of course, that one finds from first to last in the works of Leonardo, because that way his tastes lay. Probably his last work, which is this meltingly androgynous figure emerging out of the mists, representing St. John the Baptist. So Leonardo's interest in beautiful, rather feminine young men is both a biographical truth and, in this case, is backed up by the scriptural story that he's representing on this wall.
There is one piece of evidence that I find particularly compelling. This V in the middle, you've got this great gap between the Mary John figure and Jesus. They've pulled away like that. Now, it seems a very odd thing for the painter to have done, because it's not as though the painter's revealing anything of interest behind. All we've got is a solid column in the middle of a window. Mm-hmm. Now, why would you do that unless actually what you wanted to indicate was something about that space itself, unless you wanted to draw a V, a holy feminine?
You could say there's an L on the side there, where it comes down to the table. There's a V there. You can find an M. The sponsor or patron of this painting was Ludovicus of Milan. Perhaps LVM stands for that. In other words, you can find alphabet soup in paintings wherever you want, just by tracing shapes.
Is it infeasible, then, that Leonardo da Vinci would have used codes in this painting?
It seems to me a misreading of the kind of man he was. He described himself once in rather memorable phrase as a disciple of experience, by which he meant observation, experiment, real things tested and observed before they're held to be true. He wasn't one who was a great believer, he was a questioner. And so I would say, to look at this painting and try to rummage around in it for cultish, hidden meanings of that sort is the misreading of Leonardo himself.
I'm actually completely split down the middle now. I can see that Charles's logical, rationalist approach to this painting is very sensible, but when I look at that figure, I don't see an effeminate man, I see a woman.
But in the Da Vinci Code, of course, she's much, much more than just a woman. She is Jesus' chief disciple, a co-author with him of Christianity. She's his wife. She's the mother of his child, and so the bearer of the holy bloodline. She is herself sacred. And the church suppressed this and recast her as a prostitute.
This is a devastating proposition that's engaged and enraged readers all over the world, particularly women. It suggests that the whole Christian church is founded on a lie. It makes a laughing stock of the debate about the ordination of women priests. And most dizzying, it suggests that somewhere in the streets today are direct descendants of Jesus Christ. And what's more, at least some of it's true.
I'm back in Jerusalem, where the story of Mary Magdalene begins. And I'm going to depart from the Da Vinci Code and Holy Blood, Holy Grail for a moment as I try to establish what history tells us about her, starting with the Bible.
After Jesus had been crucified, his body was wrapped in a shroud and then he was laid in a tomb. Many people think it was this one. And then a big boulder was rolled across the entrance. Then, on the third day after the crucifixion, Mary Magdalene, who'd been present at his death, came into the garden and she was astonished to find that the big stone had been rolled away from the entrance to the tomb, and inside it, Jesus had disappeared, and in his place there was an angel who told her that Christ had risen again and she should go out and spread the news. And as she ran into the garden, she saw Jesus himself. In other words, she was the very first person to see Jesus after his resurrection.
Mary was also one of only three of Jesus's followers to witness the crucifixion. But these are her only significant appearances in the New Testament, and most scholars thought of her as a peripheral figure, until a chance discovery in the Egyptian desert some 60 years ago.
In December 1945, a peasant farmer called Muhammad Ali al-Saman made an amazing discovery. He was digging in the Egyptian desert in a place called Nag Hammadi, and he was looking for sabak, which is a kind of loose soil which they use over there for fertilizer. But instead, he found this meter-high earthenware jar. And at first, he didn't want much to do with it because he thought maybe there were evil spirits inside it. And then he thought, you never know, there could be gold in here. So he gave it a whack with his mattock. And there wasn't gold, and there weren't any spirits. What there were 13 papyrus books covered in leather. So he took them home, and his mum chucked some of them on the fire to use as fuel, and the rest he either sold or gave away.
Muhammad Ali had discovered and nearly destroyed what are now known as the Gnostic Gospels. And for biblical scholars, their discovery was dynamite.
These were remarkable texts that one of the first of them opens with the words, "These are the secret sayings which the living Jesus spoke."
The texts contain the teachings of some of the very first Christians. They include detailed accounts of the life and death of Jesus. In these accounts, Mary's no longer a bit part player. She's a colorful character, center stage at the birth of Christianity. She's even got a gospel named after her.
In the Gospel of Mary, she claims to have teaching from Jesus and understandings from Jesus that were not given to the others, and that she's a particularly close disciple to whom he entrusted his deeper teaching.
When there's a dialogue between Jesus and the disciples, she doesn't always ask questions. Rather, her role is to make answers and to make statements.
The Gospel of Philip suggests, too, that Mary Magdalene was especially close to Jesus. The Gospel of Thomas also suggests that she was one of the intimate circle of disciples.
Well, well, well. Perhaps there's something in the Da Vinci Code and Holy Blood, Holy Grail after all. Because while this Mary is not quite their sacred object of worship, she's not far off it. She's an important disciple, she teaches doctrine, and she appears to be Jesus's number two. What's more, her story was, as both books suggest, suppressed after her death by a male-dominated church.
I think it's clear that the suppression of traditions, including Mary Magdalene as a disciple, has a great deal to do with the bishops who declared that women should have no part in leadership in the churches. We also know from the fathers of the church, from the famous church father Tertullian, who tells us in a tirade against women, these heretical women, how audacious they are. They baptize, they teach. He said, you just don't know. They claim share in every masculine office. The Archbishop of Alexandria sent a letter at Easter time out to the monks of Egypt, telling them that they should get rid of the illegitimate secret books that they liked and kept in the monasteries, and that they could keep 27 of those books. This is actually the first known list of the 27 books that are in the New Testament in that letter, his letter of the year 367. It seems that some monk at the monastery, or several, took many books out of the monastery, sealed them into an ancient jar to preserve them, and hid them out on the cliff where they were discovered by Muhammad Ali some 1600 years later.
The church had buried the Gnostic Gospels, and Mary with them, in the dust of Nag Hammadi. The final indignity came a few hundred years later when Pope Gregory the Great falsely denounced her as a prostitute, a slander that was to last more than 1,000 years. For many people, this will be shocking stuff, not least because it's relatively close to the story told in the Da Vinci Code and Holy Blood, Holy Grail. But in both books, it's just the starting point, because they and other bloodline theorists take the suppression and the evidence of a close relationship between Jesus and Mary and they run with it. And boy, do they run with it.
Some of these early books talked of a relationship between Jesus and Mary Magdalene that was extremely close. One even speaks of him kissing her on the lips.
The other apostles are jealous, and jealous of this intimacy, and they ask Jesus why he loves her more than them.
If we look at it from another angle, if Jesus hadn't been married, this is so unusual for a Jewish man of the time that it would have been noted. He would have been criticized for it. It would have turned up in some documents.
That's an argument that's convinced many people, but not biblical scholars.
The Gospel of Philip says that Jesus used to kiss her often on the, and there, intriguingly enough, the manuscript breaks off. People have frequently reinserted, he used to kiss her often on the mouth, but that's a scholarly interpolation of what might have been there. We don't know where Jesus kissed her. It might have been on the cheek, the forehead, the nose, could have been the mouth, but that doesn't necessarily have to have been sexual. We have 6 or 7 references to kissing in the New Testament that was part of the kind of Christian greeting. Doesn't necessarily have to have anything sexual to it. There are those who would say that Jesus had to have been married because of the cultural and religious mandate that the men should go out, be fruitful, and multiply. Jesus did not live by the culture's expectations. He said, blessed are the poor. People would say, really? Blessed are the poor? That would go so against their understanding of what it was to be in harmony with God and to be blessed with wealth. And therefore, I don't think that Jesus was necessarily married, and there's good evidence that those who had a strong spiritual dedication to God did not marry.
The clincher for me, no pun intended, is that the marriage of the Messiah surely would have found its way into somebody's gospel, and it didn't, not even into any of the suppressed ones. But fans of the bloodline theory go much further than just marrying the two of them. They claim the union produced issue, and that the resulting holy bloodline is the Holy Grail.
The Holy Grail, but the French say Saint Graal, and in medieval times that was written like this, Saint Graal. But when two of the leading characters in the Da Vinci Code are talking, one of them explains to the other that much earlier than the medieval, in the very earliest of times, the two words were divided a different way, like that. In other words, Saint Real. And that means royal blood.
When I read that, I got goosebumps. It was like, oh no, no wonder.
Margaret Starbird is author of another book on which the Da Vinci Code draws. In The Woman with the Alabaster Jar, she makes the vital link between Mary Magdalene and the Holy Bloodline. She supplies the child. Starbird's version of events takes us back to the heart of Grail country. To an annual festival in the French coastal town of Saint-Marie-de-la-Mer. The locals are celebrating a popular and enduring legend. It concerns the arrival on their beach 2,000 years ago of a boatload of refugees from the Holy Land.
The legend is that Mary Magdalene and her brother and sister and friends showed up in this little boat with no oars, and they brought with them the Holy Grail, the Blood Royal. Well, you don't carry the Blood Royal around in a jar. It's actually a child that carries the Blood Royal. And there is a legend then, there is a child on the boat. That was the thing I think that struck me when I started praying about this story. There was a child on the boat. Everyone thinks the child has to be male, but in this case, the child on the boat was female. And her name was Sarah. Sarah means princess in Hebrew, and the legend calls her Sarah. So if there's a little girl on the boat and her name is Sarah, which is Hebrew for princess, well, who do you think she is? You know, I just drew that, I just made a deduction. It was a deductive leap.
And it's a deductive leap with breathtaking implications. Because if it's true, there could be people walking the earth today, perhaps even you and me, who are descended through Sarah from Christ. Unfortunately, science hasn't yet devised a way of detecting holy DNA. But we can check out the evidence on which the claim is based. It appears to be shaky, not least because Starbird may have misinterpreted the legends. There is one that brings Mary Magdalene to France, but not here. Just ask the locals who was with Sarah in this boat.
There is only Mary Jacobi and Mary Salome. This is really their festival.
Two biblical Marys, neither one Mary Magdalene. And Sarah, whatever her name means in Hebrew, is no princess.
Sarah was the servant, the Egyptian servant of the two Marys. She came with them from Palestine on the boat.
There's no evidence that Mary Magdalene came to France. What happens is you get a lot of legends. They start about the 4th or 5th century, and the whole of this becomes crystallized in the 13th century in a book called The Golden Legend. But it is strictly a legendary tradition. It wasn't regarded as true even in the Middle Ages.
An object lesson in the pitfalls of legends. But the ancient division of sang graal into sang real, holy grail into holy blood, seems like a much more solid proposition.
Of all the arguments that Dan Brown marshals in support of his claim that the grail is the holy bloodline, this has got to be the most compelling. It's neat, it's logical, it feels authentic, it makes sense. There's just one tiny problem. It's rubbish.
One of the key questions, both in the Da Vinci Code and in what appears to be its sort of core source, Holy Blood, Holy Grail, is effectively a misreading of a 15th century writer. A man called John Harding was writing about the Grail romances and Grail history, but he mistranscribed the words sang graal to sang graal, to holy blood, instead of holy grail. Now, Bagent and the writers of the Holy Blood, Holy Grail took this error as a core, you know, suddenly a core revelation that this was the reality of the Holy Grail, that in fact it was about holy blood. And effectively, they're playing upon one man's error and playing it into suddenly a key revelation in history.
The bloodline is unraveling in my hands. Surely the author of the book that first suggested Jesus and Mary Magdalene had a child can help. He must have something, some shred of evidence that holds his theory together.
Do we have any evidence that there was a child?
There's none whatsoever. It's purely hypothesis on our part, but I think it's a plausible hypothesis. If the Holy Grail is the bloodline of David, and if Jesus and Mary Magdalene had been married and she was pregnant with his child, yes, she would have carried the Grail to France. And I think this is the way we need to look at this material. Is it true? I don't know. Is it plausible? Yes.
So the inspiration for the Da Vinci Code and a whole canon of secret Grail hunts is no more than a big guess.
What Bagent and his co-writers have done is attempt to draw in so many, such a range of different ideas to throw out any real interest in basing their writings on facts. They actually say in the work, you know, you can't just confine yourself to interest in fact. So effectively what they're doing is throwing out all kind of critical questioning and just putting in any idea that they can find, that any links that they can possibly suggest.
There's history and there's imagination. And imagination doesn't work like history, and history doesn't work like imagination. If you want to say that there's a secret which belongs to the world of the imagination. I agree with you 100%, but it belongs to the world of the imagination, and it's no good pretending that it is a kind of alternative history.
So after 10,000 miles on the road and a bucket full of Grail theories, I'm back where I started. Empty-handed, but a little bit wiser. And I'm certainly a lot clearer about the truth behind the best-selling novel of our time. It seems to me that the Da Vinci Code has drawn on a range of sources dismissed by most historians as pure fantasy.
And to be frank, in my opinion, it's not even particularly well written. But so what? Dan Brown isn't the first person to have a smash hit writing that way, and he certainly won't be the last. So good luck to him. Because what he's done is what the romance writers did 800 years ago. He's put something at the centre of his novel that we'd all love to be true, but know in our heart of hearts never can be. The Holy Grail.
And step into the shadowy world and see if you can solve your own cryptic puzzle at channel4.com/weirdworlds. And that's where you can also take part in a live web chat right now with the producer of the programme, Simon Rakes. Now, coming up next here on 4 Sex in the 70s goes between the covers of the book The Joy of Sex.